Hey guys, I hope everybody's having a great Wednesday. I wanted to bring an article, a professional published article, to the channel so that people can understand, hopefully understand a little bit better about digital evidence. This paper was published, it's wrote by Rodney McKimmish. And I'm going to show you who that gentleman is. Okay, this is Rod McKimmish. He's from Sydney, Australia. And this is his LinkedIn profile. Just, I wanted to pull that up so we could see his qualifications for writing the paper in the first place. He has a 20 plus years experience in building businesses and managing teams, specializing in computer forensics, cyber forensics, and data analytics. Excuse me. He provides expert witness services for both civil and criminal investigations. And his specialties include computer forensics, intrusion and cyber forensics, electronic discovery, data analytics, expert reports for technology-based copyright infringement, IP disputes, and general technology-related disputes, and social network analysis. And he wrote this paper, and I think it's a good place to start if you really don't know a whole lot about digital forensics. And so I have installed a program to read it, because who in the world wants to listen to me stumbling through an article? I know I sure don't. I don't mind reading it, but I don't want to be the one stumbling through it and having to listen to it, so... With you guys in mind, I installed this voice program. So, I'm not gonna play this whole entire article, because the entirety of the article would be rather lengthy. But just the high points and basically parts that pertain to the Kenneka Jenkins case. That's where I'm gonna hit. So, I think it's interesting, and with that being said, I'm going to get back to the article.
Chapter 1. When is digital evidence forensically sound? Rodney McKimmish. Abstract forensically sound is a term used extensively in the digital forensics community to qualify and, in some cases, to justify the use of a particular forensic technology or methodology. Indeed, many practitioners use the term when describing the capabilities of a particular piece of software or when describing a particular forensic analysis approach. Such a wide application of the term can only lead to confusion. This paper examines the various definitions of forensic computing, also called digital forensics, and identifies the common role that admissibility and evidentiary weight play. Using this common theme, the paper explores how the term forensically sound has been used and examines the drivers for using such a term. Finally, a definition of forensically sound is proposed and four criteria are provided for determining whether or not a digital forensic process may be considered to be forensically sound. One, introduction. Emerging from the needs of law enforcement in the 1980s, forensic computing, also referred to as digital forensics, has evolved to become an integral part of most criminal investigations. The digital forensic specialist plays a fundamental role in the investigative process, whether it is the forensic analysis of personal computers, cell phones, and PDAs belonging to suspects and witnesses, or the acquisition and analysis of network traffic in response to computer security incidents. Forensic computing also plays an increasingly important role in civil litigation, especially in electronic discovery, intellectual property disputes, employment law disputes, and IT security incidents. In the context of law enforcement, it has been argued that the emergence of forensic computing as a discipline was due to the need to provide technical solutions to legal problems. 6. The technical solution involves the extraction of electronic data by processes that ensure that the resulting product is legally acceptable as evidence. Some scholars argue that legal drivers are the principal force behind shaping the growth and evolution of forensic computing. 19. As in the case of criminal investigations, the need to meet evidentiary requirements also provides a strong stimulus for forensic computing in civil litigation. Not surprisingly, a common element that emerges from forensic computing in criminal and civil matters is the need to produce electronic evidence in a manner that does not detract from its admissibility. The growing emphasis on admissibility in recent years has caused the focus of the forensic computing discipline to shift to the domain of forensic science. With this shift comes the need to formalize many of the forensic processes and procedures that have been developed in an unstructured or ad hoc manner. Evidence of the shift is apparent in NIST's Computer Forensic Tools Testing Program 15, as well as in the work of the Scientific Working Group on Digital Evidence (SWGDE) 20, and the Electronic Evidence Technical Advisory Group of the Australian National Institute of Forensic Science, which is helping integrate the forensic computing function into the forensic science domain. 14. The need to ensure that electronic evidence produced by a forensic process is admissible has given rise to the term forensically sound when seeking to describe the reliability of the forensic process. Before exploring what forensically sound means, we briefly examine current thinking about the discipline of forensic computing.
Forensically sound is a term that you're going to hear a lot in this article, and that's pretty important to know what that is, especially in this case. I skipped down just a little bit so that we can get to that section.
Three, forensically sound evidence. To better understand what the term forensically sound might actually mean, we first examine the usage of the term. An internet search quickly shows that the term is used to characterize everything from disk imaging software to a particular approach for extracting computer data. In the context of disk imaging, digital forensics professionals qualify the term by stating that to be forensically sound, the disk image must be a bit-for-bit copy of the original, i.e., an exact copy. Some go further by adding that the disk imaging process must not only produce an exact copy, but must also include a means for verifying the authenticity of the copy and the reliability of the copying process. Authenticity is typically ensured by using some form of mathematical fingerprinting or hashing that provides a signature for a given block of data. To ensure reliability, it is often advocated that the disk imaging process include an audit trail that clearly records the success or failure of all or part of the copying process. Therefore, one might argue that, in order to be forensically sound, a disk imaging process must satisfy the following requirements. The disk imaging process must produce an exact representation, copy, of the original. The duplicated data must be independently authenticated as being a true copy.
For those that maybe may not understand what this is really relating to, this is in regards to the surveillance footage and how it was acquired from the Crown Plaza. And then also how it was supplied to the forensic lab that reviewed it and who also gave it back to the police. You have to follow the chain of custody. So the Crown Plaza supplied it to the Rosemont Police Department. The Rosemont Police Department supplied it to a forensic imaging lab of some sort. And the lab, I believe it was actually the Target lab. And the Target lab then gave it back to to the Rosemont Police Department. And that's the chain of command on that. So here we go. I'm going to continue the video.
The duplicated data must be independently authenticated as being a true copy. The disk imaging process must produce an audit trail. A more authoritative overview of the disk imaging process is found in NIST's Disk Imaging Tool Specification, version 3.1.6, 16. The document specifies a number of mandatory and optional requirements for disk imaging tools. The principal requirements are: the tool shall make a bitstream duplicate or an image of an original disk or partition. The tool shall not alter the original disk. The tool shall be able to verify the integrity of a disk image file. The tool shall log I/O errors. The documentation of the tool shall be correct. When the term forensically sound is used to describe the forensic process as a whole, it is done so with two clear objectives. 1. The acquisition and subsequent analysis of electronic data has been undertaken with all due regard to preserving the data in the state in which it was first discovered. 2. The forensic process does not in any way diminish the evidentiary value of the electronic data through technical, procedural, or interpretive errors. It is often the case that to meet these objectives, the concept of forensically sound is expressed in terms of a series of steps or procedures to be followed. While this approach is logical and is certainly the most measurable, in reality, it is the lack of uniformity that diminishes its value. Specifically, the steps or procedures often vary from one author to the next and may contain more or less detail. Additionally, the forensic perspective and experience of an author can have a significant bearing on the construction of the forensic process. For example, consider the difference in the acquisition of data in computer forensics and intrusion forensics cases. In computer forensics, the focus is on obtaining a snapshot of the system at a given point in time, typically using a disk imaging process. In the case of intrusion forensics, the focus is more likely to be on monitoring and collecting data from a network over time. It is, therefore, difficult to advocate taking a disk image of a live system whose state changes over time and where the evidence, network traffic and log files, is in a dynamic state. Compounding the uncertainty surrounding the meaning and use of the term forensically sound is the lack of a clear definition or concise discussion in the digital forensics literature. For example, Guidelines for the Management of IT Evidence 7, published by Standards Australia, uses the term forensically sound in the context of evidence collection, but does not clarify its meaning. An alternate approach used to qualify forensic processes centers on the adoption of several principles rather than the application of clearly defined steps or processes. The Good Practice Guide for Computer-Based Electronic Evidence, published by the Association of Chief Police Officers, United Kingdom 13, lists four important principles related to the recovery of digital evidence. 1. No action taken by law enforcement agencies or their agents should change data held on a computer or storage media which may subsequently be relied upon in court. 2. In exceptional circumstances, where a person finds it necessary to access original data held on a computer or on storage media, that person must be competent to do so and be able to give evidence explaining the relevance and the implications of their actions. 3. An audit trail or other record of all processes applied to computer-based electronic evidence should be created and preserved. An independent third party should be able to examine those processes and achieve the same result. 4. The person in charge of the investigation, the case officer, has overall responsibility for ensuring that the law and these principles are adhered to. Similarly, the International Organization on Computer Evidence 10 has specified the following 6 principles. 1. When dealing with digital evidence, all of the general forensic and procedural principles must be applied. 2. Upon seizing digital evidence, actions taken should not change that evidence. 3. When it is necessary for a person to access original digital evidence, that person should be trained for the purpose. 4. All activity relating to the seizure, access, storage or transfer of digital evidence must be fully documented, preserved and available for review. 5. An individual is responsible for all actions taken with respect to digital evidence while the digital evidence is in his or her possession. 6. Any agency, which is responsible for seizing, accessing, storing or transferring digital evidence, is responsible for compliance with these principles. The well-known U.S. Department of Justice publication, Searching and Seizing Computers and Obtaining Electronic Evidence in Criminal Investigations, 22, does not list any principles per se. However, the publication does address many of the points discussed above and provides a comprehensive explanation of the forensic process and the related U.S. legal issues. In a 1999 paper titled, What is Forensic Computing? McCamish 12 specified four rules aimed at maximizing the admissibility of digital forensic processes. These rules, which are similar to the principles described above, are 1. Minimal handling of the original. The application of digital forensic processes during the examination of original data shall be kept to an absolute minimum. 2. Account for any change. Where changes occur during a forensic examination, the nature, extent, and reason for such changes should be properly documented. 3. Comply with the rules of evidence. The application or development of forensic tools and techniques should be undertaken with regard to the relevant rules of evidence. 4. Do not exceed your knowledge. A digital forensics specialist should not undertake an examination that is beyond his or her current level of knowledge and skill. 4. Why define forensically sound? Despite the variations in the use of forensically sound, there remains one universally consistent objective for a digital forensic process, the need to ensure that the end product does not lose its evidentiary weight and, therefore, its admissibility as evidence. Given this overriding consideration, it is not surprising to see an ever-increasing number of digital forensics professionals referring to their work product as being derived from a forensically sound methodology and/or technology. Indeed, this term is commonly used in affidavits and expert reports, especially when justifying the use of a specific methodology or technology. The greatest driver to defining the term forensically sound may, in fact, come from the legal community. In 2005, the Australian Law Reform Commission (ALRC) released a review of the various Australian Uniform Evidence Acts too. The section titled Reliability and Accuracy of Computer-Produced Evidence examines the Australian legislative framework that facilitates the proof of electronic evidence. The ALRC analysis identifies several viewpoints. One viewpoint, which relies heavily on the work of Spenceley, 21, emphasizes that a higher threshold for the admission of computer-produced output into evidence should be established. Citing Spenceley's research, the ALRC review notes that a question could be raised about the reliability of computer-generated output because it is impossible to test for either the inaccuracy or accuracy of computer operations, and impossible to give a statistical rate of failure, and that there is therefore no rational basis for assuming a high rate of reliability. To negate the impact of questions about reliability, the ALRC review notes that Spenceley builds a case for adopting an approach that relies on implementing a redundant mechanism in the environment in which the computer is used to address the problem of reliability of computer output. The purpose of the redundant mechanism is to prevent or mitigate unreliability by helping provide some level of verification that a failure in the computer has not occurred. To achieve this goal, the ALRC review cites Spenceley's test of admissibility. It should be demonstrated that some mechanisms of redundancy, however formulated and implemented, was or were utilized in connection with the production of particular material in the setting in which it was produced, and that b) it is reasonably likely that any errors in the operation of that computer that affected the accuracy of information contained in that material would have been detected by such mechanisms. Not surprisingly, when government entities such as ALRC begin to probe the evidentiary value of computer-generated output and, in particular, raise questions about the current reliance on computer-generated output, greater attention is automatically placed on the digital forensic process. Given the variation in the usage of the term forensically sound and the focus on the reliability of computer-generated output from an evidentiary perspective, two key questions arise. What does forensically sound mean? How does one know if something is forensically sound? The answer to these questions is important when one considers that the term forensically sound is used to not only substantiate a particular forensic technology or methodology, but also to substantiate it in the context of proving the admissibility of the digital forensic output in legal proceedings. This last point makes it all the more critical that there be a clear understanding of what makes something forensically sound. 5. What does forensically sound mean? The Compact Oxford English Dictionary 17 defines the word forensic as meaning 1. Relating to or denoting the application of scientific methods to the investigation of crime. 2. Of or relating to courts of law. The same dictionary defines the word sound in the context of something is said to be sound as meaning 1. In good condition. 2. Based on reason or judgment. 3. Financially secure. 4. Competent or reliable. 5. Of sleep, deep and unbroken. 6. Severe or thorough. Utilizing these individual definitions, it may be argued that the term forensically sound means the production of reliable electronic evidence before a court of law. In the context of digital evidence, however, the question of reliability is perhaps the key element. Consequently, and given the variations in the use of the term as detailed above, a more concise definition of forensically sound is the application of a transparent digital forensic process that preserves the original meaning of the data for production in a court of law. The word transparent in this definition implies that the reliability and accuracy of the forensic process is capable of being tested and/or verified. The phrase preserves the original meaning intimates that the data derived from the forensic process must be capable of being correctly interpreted. In addition to these points, it is worth noting that the term digital forensic process covers not only the methodology employed, but also the underlying technology. 5.1 Evaluation Criteria. Reliability and completeness are the two most critical properties.
Okay, so if we go back to the files that the Village of Rosemont had released, this is pitiful. I had to come in the bathroom to get away from that dang cat. It's pitiful. This is the report on that. It says on 9/11/2017, PSO Dan Pavella, an evidence technician, was assigned to take video of the path the victim is believed to have walked from her hotel room to the freezer. I arrived at 5440 River Road and began taking video at approximately 1301 hours. I finished taking video at approximately 1405 hours. All video was taken on a department-issued Sony Handycam HDR 240 camera. The videos were burned onto a DVD and logged into evidence as item DVD-1. The DVD was placed in locker number 4. He did this on 9/11/2017. And it's just weird how he worded that. He says, take video of the path the victim is believed to have walked from her hotel room to the freezer. Okay. Another piece of digital forensic information in this case was from 9/21/2017 by Officer PSO Joseph Piscatelli. On 9/20/2017, I analyzed and reviewed the material from the forensic phone examination of blah, personal cell phone. The examination provides detailed information from the phone, including text messages, call logs, pictures, videos, etc. I was not able to observe any pictures or videos that may have been taken at the Crown Plaza Hotel from the night of 9/8/2017, leading into the early morning of 9/9/2017. I was able to observe conversations Abriana had leading up to her attending the party and after Kenneka Jenkins went missing. The text messages are as follows. So you can take that paragraph and use the context clues and figure out that these are Bree's texts. Excuse me. It says blank in this conversation is talking to quote favor blank. It appears favor is asking her about her plans for the night. The conversation is as follows. favor. This is from 9/9/2017 at 4:30 a.m. UTC time. Text, what happened? You went? Bree says at 4:35, 5 minutes later. Not yet. I'm finna get in the car with Kenneka and go park. By her house. Because you didn't even know the bitch had a donut on her car. Favor. A few seconds later says, oh, she in her own car and she knew she had a donut on it when she said they can see it? Bree says, yeah. I guess she ain't even tell me. I just noticed it myself in that hotel in Rosemont. I don't want to be driving on the E-way like that. Okay, so the cat seems to have quieted down now. So, approximately 3.5 hours later, Blank sent a text to Favor stating they cannot find Kenneka. She also describes Kenneka to be drunk at the time. The conversation is as follows. Blank, who we're assuming to be Bree. When they lost Kenneka, she drunk. Let me zoom in because I just can't see that. When they lost Kenneka, she drunk and can't find her. Favor. Find Kenneka. I can't believe y'all lost her. Bree. Bitch, we done searched this bitch from top to bottom. And that's at 9:07:36 a.m. UTC. Bree. Again. At 9/9/11:50 UTC time. Oh my grandma, this bitch dumb. Favor at 9:12:18. Don't leave her, bro. Another conversation analyzed was with Blank and Ma. In this particular conversation, she describes Kenneka to be real drunk at the time she went missing. Conversation is as follows. Ma. Maybe she with a little boy or in the car with somebody else. Blank. She not. She was real drunk and she don't talk to no boys. Ma. Probably in the car with somebody else she know. Blank. We asked everybody that was there. Ma then states that Kenneka could not have just disappeared and that Blank should check hotel again, to which Blank states, that's what we saying, but she wouldn't just leave her mama car in it. It's been three hours. We knocked on every door, went to every floor and everything. We searched the parking garage and all. Blank later has a conversation with the phone number of Blank, to which she stated the following regarding Kenneka. We came to the hotel party and she got real drunk and next thing you know, we couldn't find her. Blank later had a conversation with Blank. Blank asked Blank if she knew where the last place she was at. Abriana replied with the following. So that was a message with Bree. The hotel with us. All the contents from the forensic phone examination were copied and inventoried accordingly. All information would be available upon request. Nothing further at this time. So, it says, all contents from this forensic phone examination were copied, doesn't say how it was copied, and inventoried accordingly. Accordingly, per who? All information would be available upon request. But you see, we saw the FOIA request last night, which probably came on in the morning by the time it uploaded to my YouTube. And they're saying, no, please refer to the files we put on the website, which that's what this is. So, Which is it? Okay, this is regarding the surveillance footage. This is from 9/22/2017 at 10:46 a.m. by Detective Anthony Delacova. Deputy Chief Kukulka, number 1455, picked up video surveillance from blank, general manager for the Crown Plaza Hotel on 12 September 2017. Due to the large file size, the video surveillance was downloaded onto an external hard drive. Okay. So Detective Delacova is the one that picked it up from the general manager at the Crown Plaza on September the 12th, 2017, several days after the hotel incident involving Kenneka. The file was so large that they put it on a hard, an external hard drive. Okay, here's some more digital evidence in this case. This was entered on 9/25/2017 at 15:24 by Officer Joseph Piscatelli on September 25th, 2017 at 08:56 hours. I submitted a quote preservation request through the law enforcement online request section of Facebook.com. The request was submitted to preserve the page of Kenneka Jenkins, username quote Kenneka Martin, and then it provides the URL address. Between 8/1/2017 and 9/10/2017. After my submission, I received a confirmation email from Facebook, case number 1266794. I then drafted and completed a search warrant for the aforementioned Facebook page, to which it was signed and approved by ASA Glenn Runk on 9/25/2017 at 13:30 hours. The signed search warrant was then brought to the Rolling Meadows 3rd District Courthouse and brought in front of Judge Cataldo in room 108. After reviewing the facts to the search warrant, Judge Cataldo signed and approved it. I then returned back to the Rosemont Police Station and submitted the signed search warrant to Facebook.com through their law enforcement online request portal, case number 1267662. Nothing further until the warrant is executed and the requested documents are sent back to our department. Okay, here's another piece speaking about digital forensics. This was entered on 9/11/2017, 1530 by Officer... Well, it says Detective Anthony Delacova. I, Detective Delacova, number 1444, met with blank, assistant general manager, blank, director of food and beverage, and blank, building engineer, from the Crown Plaza Hotel on 11 September 2017 at approximately 1301 hours. The hotel employees accompanied PSO Pavella, number 1414, and I through the believed path Kenneka Jenkins took to the freezer on the night of the incident. Based on video surveillance and witness statements, PSO Pavella captured videography of the believed path traveled by Kenneka. Reference PSO Pavella's report for further details. I asked blank if he knew what temperature the freezer was supposed to be set at during normal operation. Blank stated he believes the typical temperature for their freezer is 0 degrees. I also asked blank if the freezer was airtight. Blank stated he believes the freezer was airtight. There's a lot of guesswork there, huh? Not a lot of for sure stuff. And so this was from the 11th of September at approximately 1 o'clock in the afternoon. and they're still talking about the believed path that she took to the freezer. And they're using this, they're referring back to the video surveillance and witness statements. It shouldn't be a believed path, and you should have a clear path. And then what the temperature of the freezer was supposed to be set at, stated he believes, and stated that he believes the freezer was airtight. Okay, here's what I was really after. This was entered on 9/26/2017, 11:25 a.m. by PSO Anthony Cusinella. This is Tuesday, September 26, 2017. On Tuesday, September the 12th, 2017, at 11:30 hours, Deputy Chief Kukulka, I can't say that name, I'm so sorry. It's K-U-K-U-L-K-A. Received an external hard drive from Blank, General Manager of Crown Plaza. DC, which stands for Deputy Chief. I'm going to call him Deputy Chief K, just to keep from stumbling over that name. DCK was informed the hard drive consisted of security surveillance footage of the Crown Plaza Hotel. The dates range from 9/8/17 through 9/10/17. The same day I received the hard drive from DCK to begin my review. I began reviewing the Crown Plaza O'Hare Hotel security surveillance footage. While doing so, I created an Excel spreadsheet, see attached, indicating dates and times of footage I observed. I also included the locations and events of my observations. The dates of observation are from 9/9/17 at 0033 hours through 9/10/17 at 0531 hours. Within the spreadsheet, I created a color-coded system under the quote notes tab. The color representations are as follows. Blue indicates if only male subjects were observed during that portion of the video. Pink indicates if only female subjects were observed within that portion of the video. Green indicates if both male and female subjects were observed during that portion of the video. Red indicates the crime scene or areas that the victim, Kenneka Jenkins, was observed within that portion of the video. During my observation, I noticed there was no activity in the, quote, kosher kitchen area prior to the victim entering that area. I contacted Blank with the Crown Plaza Hotel. I asked Blank if I could receive footage of the last person entering the area prior to the victim. Blank informed me the camera in the, quote, kosher kitchen is motion activated. The external hard drive provided the dates in question. The last motion activation of that camera was on 8/30/2017. Therefore, it was not included originally with the hard drive. On 9/13/2017, at 12:30 hours, I received a thumb drive with the additional footage, which dates back to 8/30/17. That was the last known date, according to the footage, that there was activity in the, quote, kosher kitchen. So when they made their initial request, they had only requested certain dates, supposedly, of the camera footage. And what they were telling them is that the kosher kitchen, which is what they wanted the video footage for, that camera is supposed to be motion activated, and that it had not been accessed since 8/30/2017. So some 10 days previous to, or whatever, roughly 10 days previous to the time when Kenneka had walked into there. So when they sent the original footage, they didn't include that footage. So he's saying that he received a thumb drive with the additional footage, which dates back to 8/30/17. All right. Here's another piece of digital information. This is from PSO James Plesko. It was entered on 10/12/2017 at 9:30 a.m. It says, "I was tasked with review of video provided by the Crowne Plaza Hotel. The date of videos was 9/10/17. I was to review video within the time frame of 0000 hours to 0045 hours. I was looking for any unusual activity within the hotel, especially in the areas around the scene where the victim was found. I found nothing out of what appeared to be normal activity, except for numerous hotel employees and members of the Rosemont Public Safety Department searching areas for the victim. No further." So this was at 0000 hours to 0045 hours on 10/17. So for 45 roughly minutes. This gentleman, Plesko, was attacked, I'm sorry, tasked to review this footage. Okay? Okay, here's another piece of digital evidence. This says it was entered on 9/27/2017 at 10:18 a.m. by Detective Anthony Dilikova. I, Detective Dilikova, number 1444, was contacted by Dr. Arunkumar from the Cook County Medical Examiner's Office on 26 September 2017. Dr. Arunkumar asked if I could meet with Dr. Howell and an investigator from the Medical Examiner's Office on 27 September 2017 at the Crowne Plaza Hotel. Arrangements were made to meet at the hotel at 08:15 hours. Detective Lieutenant Muich, number 1428, Detective Sergeant Rose, number 1454, and I met with Dr. Howell and Investigator Kalka, Chief of Investigations, Office of the Medical Examiner, on September 27, 2017, at approximately 8:15 hours at the Crowne Plaza Hotel. We showed Dr. Howell and Investigator Kalka the believed path Kenneka Jenkins took from the ninth floor to the freezer where she was found. Investigator Kalka took progressive photographs of the path. Additionally, we reviewed details of this case and our investigation with Dr. Howell and Investigator Kalka. We answered any questions Dr. Howell or Investigator Kalka had about the case. So on the 27th of September, some 12 days, let's just say 2 weeks roughly after the death of Kanika, Dr. Arunkumar from the Cook County Medical Examiner's Office contacted Detective Dilikova and asked if he, Dilikova, could meet with Dr. Howell and an investigator from the Medical Examiner's Office back at the Crowne Plaza. Detective Muich, Detective Sergeant Rose, and Detective Dilikova all met with Dr. Howell and Investigator Kalka back at the Crowne Plaza, and they showed Dr. Howell, those three people from the Rosemont Police Department, showed Dr. Howell and the investigator the believed path Kenneka took from the ninth floor all the way down to the freezer where she was found. And then it also says that the investigator took pictures of that path. And then they stuck around and kind of compared notes on the case. And here's more digital forensic evidence. This was entered into evidence on 9/27/2017 by Sergeant Thomas Dulles. Supplemental report, attempt to contact, Facebook messages. On 9/27/17, Sergeant Doulas, number 1438, sent Facebook messages to the following individuals using the listed URL for each. And there are five people listed here. The message to each stated, quote, "This is the Rosemont Public Safety Department Investigations Division. We have made multiple attempts to contact you. Please call us at 847-823-1139 as soon as possible, so a detective can speak with you regarding an investigation at the Crown Plaza Hotel. I sent the message through a created Facebook page, www.facebook.com/rose.montpd.3. Nothing further at this time." Okay, here's another piece of digital forensics. Entered 10/2/2017 at 1:47 by PSO James Plesko. RO reviewed Crown Plaza Hotel security video dated 9/8/2017 that was provided by the hotel to the Rosemont Police Department. This video ranges in the approximate time frame of about 1800 on 9/8/2017 to just past 0000 hours on 9/9/2017. In the videos I reviewed, I found only one that possibly had individuals who might have attended the event related to this investigation. The video was titled Pass Elevators 1. However, the video is of the main lobby looking toward the front desk and front entry doors. The timestamp on the video was 23:46:30, when the subjects in question are observed in the video, four female black subjects approximately 18 to 25 years of age enter the hotel through the main doors and walk toward the area of the elevators. No further at this time. So, PSO James Plesko, I'm sorry, I have to do this. I have to review it in my mind what I just read on something like this. James Plesko reviewed a video from 1800 on 9/8 to 0000 hours on 9/9, and he only found one thing that might have been possibly related to this investigation, and it was on a video titled Pass Elevators 1, which was facing the main lobby looking toward the front desk and front entry doors, and it was actually at 23:46:30 was the timestamp when the subjects in question are observed, which would be four female black subjects approximately 18 to 25 years of age entering through the main doors, and they walk towards the elevators. So there's a timestamp that should match up to this report right here. So at 23:46:30, you should see four female black subjects, approximately 18 to 25, come through the main doors of the hotel, walk through the lobby, and head towards the elevators. That should, if that does not line up, that is a bad thing. And here is the forensic services report from Target. Let's go through this. This is dated October the 3rd, 2017. It's got a lab reference number. It's to Anthony Cusinella. It says, "You submitted video and or images to Target's Forensic Services Laboratory for image and or video clarification." For those that don't know, Target provides this service for a lot of people, so this is not unusual. "The clarified image and or video are being returned along with this document. Please be aware of the following. These clarified images and or videos are intended for investigative use only. They are suitable for BOLO or alert bulletins." BOLO means be on the lookout, or alert bulletins. "But they should not be considered evidence. The original item should be preserved as evidence according to your policies. This is not a forensic examination or analysis of evidence, but our laboratory's image and video processing guidelines were used. The clarification steps performed were chosen based on the nature of the original item, which contain a finite amount of information. Often, only limited improvements are realized. It is not uncommon for the clarifications to show only marginal improvement. If you also submitted a request for video or image analysis, year, make, model determination, comparative analysis, etc., the results of that exam will be reported separately. These materials are being provided as early as possible to aid in your investigative activities. There are no notes. It says discovery. The materials related to the work we do is subject to discovery. Discovery orders should be directed to the appropriate address below. Please include our case number in any correspondence. Testimony. It says target's examiners are available to testify regarding the work they do. Questions regarding testimony availability or requests for examiner curriculum vitaes should be directed to forensics@target.com. Subpoenas should be directed to the address below. Please include our case number in any correspondence. It says if you have any questions regarding this letter or the returned image video, please contact forensics@target.com or call 1-800-949-9999 using option 2. And it is signed Julie Carnes, Forensic Analyst. You go to page 2, it says it's a Forensic Services Outbound Evidence Transfer Receipt. So they have to maintain that chain of custody. Evidence was relinquished by Julie Carnes. She's with the Target Forensic Services. The evidence was received back by Anthony Cusinella. It was sent via UPS. And there's a tracking number. The date and time was 10/3/2017 at 3:21 p.m. It was sent in a manila envelope. And it was a thumb drive. And then there's this second page here that's turned sideways for whatever reason. It says, I'm also sending your original evidence via UPS second day. And it has a tracking number. Included in this package is an outbound evidence receipt form. Please sign and fax this form to 763-440-9730. Or sign, scan, and email the form to forensics@target.com. This form concludes our chain of custody within the lab. Thank you, and don't hesitate to contact us if you have any additional questions. And then it says, these are instructions for opening this report up. It says, in your workspace, you will see the materials available for downloading. Check the box next to each item and choose the download button to copy these materials to your computer. Interesting. Then it says, important, while you can click on the link of each file name, this only opens a viewer that attempts to show you the contents of the file. It does not work with all of the file types we use and should not be relied on as the method to view your results. Instead, download the files to your computer. Your files will be downloaded all at once into a specific folder. And it has a little picture of something downloading. It says there is no size limit on the files that can be downloaded. Realize, however, that downloading may take a significant amount of time depending upon the size of the files and the speed of your network. Online help is available here and has a little link that you can click, hyperlink. Additional assistance is available through forensics@target.com or by calling our laboratory staff at 1-800-949-9999 using option 2. Adding other users. If you need other people to access the return materials that are stored in this workspace, you can add them directly to the workspace. You will be set up as the manager of the workspace, so by using the manager users function under options, that's where they can go to change that. Our involvement is not required. In other words, don't bother us with it. Note that in order for us to add you as a manager of the workspace, which enables you to add additional users, you must have previously been granted access to Acelion through the My Access tool. Then it says return of physical evidence. Then here is an email from Julie Carnes sent on October the 3rd, 2017 at 3:32 p.m. to Anthony Cusinella and Sean Rose. And they courtesy copied forensics. The subject is case closed. TFSL-17-0294. And it also has an attachment or a couple of attachments. Alright. We have completed this image clarification request. Please see the attached for more information. I have uploaded 26 clarified still images. The Target Forensic Services Laboratory uses the Acelion portal to securely exchange digital files, including digital evidence, reports, and examination work product with laboratory requesters. This eliminates the need to exchange these materials on CD/DVD via UPS or FedEx. Please visit https://secureshare.target.com to access the files related to your examination. This portal is intended for short-term, secure sharing of data. You have 30 days from today to log into this system and download these materials. If this is your first time visiting the Acelion portal, you simply need to log on using the email address we have on file. You will be prompted to create a password. Using your credentials, the Acelion platform can be accessed from any web browser. If you have departmental restrictions that make the use of this tool difficult, consider alternative ways to upload the files while still complying with your agency's policies. Return of report/work product. Number 1, log into your Acelion portal. Verify that you see the quote workspace related to your case. And then that's where this other page kicks in. So they scanned them out of order. So that's all on this report. So now that we're getting close to an hour and I've marked my place where I'm at, with the files, I'm going to try to break this into smaller videos because nobody's going to sit here and listen to hours and hours and hours of this stuff. It's just better if you get it in small doses because then you can retain a lot more and you can pay better attention. I mean, even I have like problems sitting through these long videos. I just can't do it. So with that being said, I'm going to end this video here and then I will pick back up a little later. And I mean, we have nothing but time right now, so. But I did want to bring a lot of this digital stuff to the forefront so people can remember all this digital stuff that was brought into this case and that has to be analyzed and it has to be handled correctly. So with that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. My phone's actually even about to die too. I hope you guys have a great day and stay healthy at home. Thank you.